And welcome to Best Girl Speaks. Wait, what? How are you? This is episode 188. Today is January. And it's Friday, not Tuesday. My brain just could not settle down enough. I'm very glary, I'm sorry. Try to turn my head a little bit. I'm gonna do this like, It'll be jaunty if I turn a little bit, right? Jaunty. So, I'm late. My brain is on full spin out. There is no traction. I have got to simmer down now. Do you get like that? It helped today. Today I just made myself do the show notes and that helped. Right. I keep trying to work on some sort of like meditative practice to try to center myself a little bit more, and I am a terrible failure at it. I know most people feel like that at the beginning, I know, but woof, I'm bad at it. It's okay, Olive, that's the UPS man, he's not coming here. Woof. So anyway, how are you? Holidays are over. Yay, no. I can't decide. But now it's January. New beginnings. I think that's why my mind is on such spin out. Do you do this? Do you get yourself so, like, wound up with potential that you literally are useless as a human being? That's useful. Not at all. Right? But it's just exciting. Like, I've never been one that's huge for New Year's resolutions, but it is certainly a time to reflect on the past year and what did and didn't work, and like how you hope to foster a better year in the future. You know what I mean? Not that last year was bad, but for example, I was going through pictures to, I wanted to put some printed photos up on the walls because we actually don't have that, right? We're such boring people. I just looked at our terrible molding in this room. This room has like plastic molding in it. Try to get back to my like Eastern European, like whatever, the house is standing, because that's all that matters. It's hard though, right? Oh, I was looking at photos. Oh, and so I realized like we don't have very many photos from last year. I know we did stuff, but we didn't like do enough stuff. And I don't mean like fancy stuff, because we don't ever do fancy stuff. But like we did not go on enough hiking things. We did not go. We only ate camping lunch. And even that, that's fine. Whatever. Sometimes it's hard to get that together. Because we do require, well, we don't require other humans, but we have much more fun if we bring other humans. And sometimes schedules just don't align. That's okay. But we need to do more, like, taking hikes and doing that kind of stuff. We did learn to ride bicycles, which was a very big deal. So, good job for us on that one. But, yeah, spend less and do more. That's my big goal. I'm sure that's, like, everybody's goal, but whatever. But so anyway, so that's, I think my mind is on total spin out right now. So I'm hoping it'll kind of, I gotta slow it down a little bit because this is not helpful to the universe or my family. I'm sure they would agree. But anyway, so let's talk about some stuff. Oh, I wanted to start by apologizing, or I shouldn't apologize, but you know, thank you for being patient when I make mistakes. Episode 187, which is the episode before this one. If you're getting this one and didn't get that one, it didn't have a title because I couldn't think of anything. But it was like the pre-Christmas episode. I somehow missed getting it up on iTunes. It was on YouTube. The iTunes upload is much finickier. It's much more persnickety. And somehow, like in the rush of holidays, I just didn't check to make sure it had actually gone through. Clearly. So, oops. But I did, that is up on iTunes now, and hopefully these will go up soon. So, whoops. I'm not going to do any shameless self-promotion this week, but I do want to mention, are you going to the Knitting Pipeline Retreat in Washington, Illinois in February? February. Okay. If you are and you would like a bag, I'm going to do pre-orders from January 20th through 24th. So that's approximately, it's a little bit less than a full month before the retreat. So it'll be January 20th through January 24th. I think I'll have a podcast before then where I can show you the actual bag. But you know, in case you occasionally, hey, how are you? Hey girl. I should do the podcast like this. Hi. Would you like to see my blemishes? In case I don't, or again, in case you're behind or whatever and you're not, whatever, it's okay. This is the fabric. And it'll have the wooden tag. That's the reason I actually do have the fabric right there. But I don't have my tags yet. They'll actually be here tomorrow, of course. So that'll be the fabric for the knitting pipeline bag this year. Isn't it cute? I'm kind of in love with it. And if you like that fabric and you won't be going to the knitting pipeline retreat, don't worry. I'll do some after I come back. So there'll be an update, you know, in February, later in February at some point. Okay. I didn't bring a pin. Oh, I did. Yay me. Okay. So shenanigans. Oh my gosh. Whatever. Crazy shenanigans. Not really crazy shenanigans at all. But you know, we did like the New Year's thing, which was fun. We had the humans over. I made a farro and cabbage and carrot and green peppers with like a Thai style dressing that had like ginger and peanut butter. That's kind of outside my flavor like familiarity world. Not that I wouldn't eat that at a place, but it's like outside of my making world. It was quite good. Do you go through this thing where after the holidays, like my body is like, if you eat another cookie, I'm gonna lay down and die. Like really, my body's just like, if you consume 1 gram of powdered sugar, I'm gonna make you feel like garbage. And they're like, but just one cookie, body. This, oh, it's a gingerbread cookie. It's brown. That means it's good for you. It's got molasses in it. That's nutritive. And your body's like, really, dude? Really? No. And you're like, oh, it's just so delicious. And you eat it. And then you're like, okay, buddy, I didn't really think you would make me feel like garbage all day. Your body's like, I told you so. Eat a vegetable. And you're like, okay, buddy. So then you decide that in order to eat a vegetable, because it's winter and I don't want to eat anything cold. Do you do that too? I like salads a lot, but like it's cold and I don't want to put cold things in my body. I even get to the point where I don't drink water that's cold in the winter. So anyway, so in order to get a sufficient amount of vegetables into my system, like in a medicinal way, I have to make vegetable soup. And I don't know about you, but I don't know how humans make vegetable soup in like a reasonable quantity. My husband openly mocks me when I make vegetable soup. Do you know those like, it's 32 quarts, right? Those big like hot water canners, not a pressure canner, but a hot water canner. It's like a lobster pot, sometimes people call it. And it's like this big around. Like it barely sits on your burner, on your oven. Your oven's like, dude, stop putting all this weight on me. So I made that full of vegetables. Because by the time you put cabbage in it and you put like all like okra, because you can't buy like two things of okra. You know what I mean? But like by the time you put like half head of cabbage is huge. You put a bunch of kale in there. Do you make your soup with V8? I totally do. Isn't that cheaty? I don't know, but it's delicious. And then you put like all the other insane like lima beans. You're like, clearly my body needs a lima bean. I don't ever eat lima beans, but in vegetable soup, clearly. I usually like put a pound of carrots. You really can't make it not in excessively ridiculous quantities. You're not supposed to cook food in those 32 quart things because they're so thin that everything sticks to them. Like you have to be really careful what's not, but luckily, like because I freeze the soup, I don't cook that. I just cook that quantity a little bit. Like, I mean, yes, a little bit more than probably really good people cook it because they like fresher vegetables than I do. Whatever, I'm from the Midwest. I like a brown green bean, people. I'm not lying. Anyway, so like you have to be very careful and like constantly stir it because that pan is like aluminum foil, basically. It's just aluminum foil. And you have to be so careful not to burn. This year, at least I started out in that pot. Usually I'm like, I'm gonna make a reasonable amount of it. And I put it in my stock pot, which is like 17 quarts or something. And then it like ends up in enough. And then you're like trying to like put it in two pots, but then like get the right ratio, because they're not equal volume pots. So you're trying to get the right ratio at each one. This year I just accepted that I'm a total idiot and put it in a giant pot. That worked out better. But then the bad thing was I had 32 quarts. I mean, I really did have like 7 gallon specials. So the bad thing is I had that much vegetable soup, so I had to put it outside to get cold because I can't put that in my refrigerator. A, 32 quarts of soup is really heavy. I was afraid I would break my refrigerator door, my refrigerator rack. Oh my god, I clean up my refrigerator. How does your refrigerator get so dirty? I don't put garbage in my refrigerator. How does it get so dirty? Anyway. Like, where does that come from? I'm sorry. It's not like I've never cleaned up my refrigerator before, but every time I like do the deep clean, the like it's the first of the year and I have to do something productive with my life because I've been sitting around on my butt eating cookies for a week. Don't judge. You do that thing, you're like, what? Again, where does garbage come from my refrigerator? Not like actual garbage, but like there's like viscous strange fluids accumulating places and drying. What was that? I don't want to know. Anyway. But so I had to put it outside because I couldn't even put it in my refrigerator because I was afraid it would melt my refrigerator. But then I couldn't leave it out all night because I was convinced that raccoons would eat it because, hi, they're humans. Would totally have eaten it. So then I had to bring it in before it got actually cold. So then I bagged it up and put it in my deep freezer. I should not have done that because it didn't... It totally like semi-defrosted my freezer. Everything else was fine. I touched everything. It was still cold. It was okay. But... I shouldn't have done that. I overwhelmed the deep freezer. Life. You're crazy. Okay? Okay. But now I got a bunch of okra and kale in me and I feel much better. Two things that led to my mind spinning. But they were good documentaries on Netflix. So I know a lot of folks have Netflix, but so you have access to it. But I watched Finding Traction, which is a documentary about ultra runner Nikki Kimball. And she runs the two... She runs... The 273 mile, the longest, is it called the longest trail? The long trail in Vermont. So that was really good. I was felt conflicted. I was very happy for her and like, it was very cool. It was very interesting. That also had like all of this like anger about how brutal she's being to her body, but like, other women who are like 30 pounds overweight are shamed and belittled for not being healthy. And I was just like, society, slow your roll. Right? Like, again, it was so cool, but I felt that tension of just like, ugh. She even said this thing and that she's, I think she's like a sports therapist, like a physical therapist of some sort. And she even said this thing at one point where she said, I would never recommend anybody do this to their body. And then at this, like, 10 minutes later, she was talking about how she's so sad that teens are overweight and their back hurts. And I'm like, you're literally, like, being packed with ice because you're torturing your body to do this. And again, I'm not judging her for doing that. I mean, she's a, it's amazing and it's a crazy accomplishment. But it is just so skewed. It is so skewed how we applaud that. But then again, a woman is 30 or 40 pounds overweight. And we're like, you're ruining healthcare. You're destroying our nation's healthcare by costing it so much money. Okay, maybe 40 pounds overweight is an injury. 100 pounds, whatever. She's 100 pounds overweight. I'm 200 pounds overweight, probably. I don't even know what I'm supposed to weigh, but it's not what I weigh. I went to the doctor once this year for my podiatrist and that's it. I'm not ruining your health care. Simmer down. I'm not talking to you. It's okay. I'm not talking to you. But that guy I'm totally talking to. He's not listening to me, of course. I'm talking to him. We're still friends. It's okay. Again, that is not to say I didn't really enjoy the documentary. I watched was Minimalism, a documentary about the important things. Now I'm so worked up that I'm a fat lady, I gotta catch my breath. Did you watch it? It's really quite good. I was struck by how many men are in that movie versus women. There are women in the movie. Don't get me wrong. But I would kind of like to know, like, if there is a skewed demographic, like, with a gender bias. Just be curious. But it was really good. Talked about, you know, again, like, just reflections on what the American dream is and what it means to each of us and all the things you think I was going to talk about. I talked about those things, so I won't talk about them too. But if it's something you're interested in, I thought it was very good. Yeah. So what I'm trying to work on is not so much the minimalization of what we have, but the minimalization of what's coming in. That is my biggest thing. I can purge till the cows come home. I'm a very good purger, but I'm not good at not consuming. But one of the things I'm trying to do right now to see if I can help myself be more aware of purchases that I make, because I'm not alone, don't get me wrong, but I do have a total knee-jerk reaction, and purchasing is way too easy, right? Like, you don't have to, not only do you not have to go somewhere to buy something now, you don't have to, like, do anything but lift something this big. Like, it's an ounce, and I bought everything in the universe. It will come to my door. I don't even have to go somewhere and get it, like, after I decide I'm gonna buy it. It's too easy, right? For me, because I will agonize over the right thing to buy, like, if there are four options. But the agony of actually deciding whether I need that or not, period, somehow escapes me. And that's what I really need to work on. So one thing I'm doing this month is, A, I'm trying not to buy anything from Amazon except business things, because I needed to buy envelopes, and that's okay. But I'm not buying anything personally from Amazon. And actually, I haven't bought anything online yet. I'm going to try to keep to that. But what I'm doing, because it's just like eating, right? Like, I decide 9 million times a day not to eat a cookie, because it actually does present itself as a question at least that many times in my brain. Did you remember when I talked about my brain spinning out? So what I'm trying to do in my journal is I'm trying to throw around everything in the world, but I'm actually keeping a log of things I didn't buy. I don't know, maybe this will help me. Because so far, it's only like the first week of January, and I've already not bought an elbow compression sleeve, a speaker for the upstairs television. What is that? I don't even know what that is. Leather conditioner, long underwear, because I don't have any long underwear pants. How did that happen? But why do I need them? I just wear two pairs of pants. Not like I'm going on an expedition. A shirt that I wanted that I didn't buy, and snow pants, which I don't even remotely need. But for a moment, I decided that to alleviate that thing, we don't do anything together, that we really need to go, we need to play hooky one day and go do snow tubing at the ski place. And clearly I would need snow pants. So I literally, what is the first thing I did? And I'm like really fresh into this trying not to buy anything thing. The first thing I did was go look and see how much snow pants were going to cost. I don't need snow pants to go. But like I need to be prepared, right? I need to be prepared for everything. And that's the first initial reaction, instead of thinking like, okay, well, how can I make this work otherwise? And so far, again, we're a weekend. And I'm like, I'm doing good so far. But whatever, it's a week I did better than last year, because I didn't even think to do this last year. So I don't know, maybe that'll help you. But I'm just looking at this list and I'm like, yeah, I'm probably gonna get that leather conditioner. But all these other things, my elbows stopped hurting. All these other things I think I could have avoided. So I wrote down the thing and how much it costs. So far, I've already saved over $200. Now, would I have definitely bought all those things immediately? I don't know, but I had the impulse to buy them. And somehow writing that down makes me, A, realize my impulse to buy things is wackadoodle. Now we're talking about nitty stuff. I'm probably going to have some weird edits in this next section, because I want to do from the boards. From the boards. where I talk about things that people wrote in on the boards. I know not all of you are in the Ravelry group or interested in the Ravelry group, but I want to really try to start doing this more often because so many of you write so many great things, and I don't know how always to reply because I'm a broken human. I know some of you are too. It's okay. But I do want to address them because they're really fun, and often they really pertain to everybody and not just me. So we're going to do from the boards, and then we're going to do some knitting and prizes for folks who donated to the podcast in November, December. If you didn't donate in November, December, just send a moment to say thank you to those people. Send the thank yous out. Because they're what makes the podcast go on. Yay, them! Yay! Okay. From the boards. We're getting a little intimate right now. I'm just going to lean in. So I will try to remember to timestamp this episode if you're not interested in this, but I think it's fun. So last week we talked about a lot of different stuff, but one of the things we talked about was my daughter. If you missed it, it was at the end, and I think it was after the shameless self-promotion. So my daughter was scheduled to get a tooth pulled. It was a baby tooth, but it was decaying, and it was right next to a permanent tooth, and they were concerned that the decay would make the permanent tooth get decayed, and so they were going to pull it. And they gave me the price breakdown, and it was $150 for the nitrogen, for the nitrous oxide, for the nitrogen. Okay, so. So Kathleen, mom of three, wrote in to say that that was a ridiculous charge for the nitrous. Hey, Kathleen, don't worry. They didn't actually charge me that much. Apparently, that's like the overestimated quote, because they actually charged me they ended up charging me $100 less for the entire visit. Because it was easy and they shouldn't have to be in the nitrous for very long. So yay! And then you have to go look. Well, you don't have to, but you should go look. AK47, F-O-R-T-Y, and the number 7, wrote a really fun story about her trip to Glacier National Park, and it's worth a read. I won't read it here because I feel like that's weird to just read it straight to you, but you, if you have a moment, go look at it. It's very cute. Did I say Glacier or Crater Lake? I often get them switched up when I'm talking, and so I do apologize about that. There's the word lake and crater and glacier sound very similar, and I know that they're two different places, but I often mismatch those words. I'm a human. And then Joanna Spring wrote in. Joanna Spring has a Etsy shop. She wrote in Spin Farm to say that one of the things I talked about last time was my dependency on the electronics. Not even dependency. It's just that knee-jerk reaction of looking at internets too long and not getting enough stuff accomplished. Again, part of the mind spin, right? Like the no traction mind spin is totally fueled by the internet. So Joanna made a suggestion. It's not for everybody, but I thought I'd put it out there for those of you who might be interested. She's starting a new internet avoidance plan where she only charges her phone or whatever device you use. I just use an iPod. But she only charges it once a week. And then her challenge is to make it through the whole week without running out of the battery, because she's not going to recharge it again until Sunday. Now, you don't have to do a whole week. Like, you could say, a lot of us could say 3 days, and that would be a vast improvement on the amount of time we're on the internets, right? I thought that was a fun challenge. And again, just think of how you could accommodate it to your, your situation. She also suggests to put your thing on Wi-Fi or on airplane mode so that you have to, go through that extra step of, and it gives you an extra moment, right? Sometimes you only need, an extra moment to think, is this really what I want to do? I know a lot of you are super grounded humans and you're what is a spazoid talking about? Boom, you're awesome. Move on. Those of us are like me and they're like, kr, 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 on your head. Right. We totally get it. Sometimes you just need an extra moment. I know I need medication. Anyway. So people reminded me that the podcast was not up. Thank you so much because I really had no idea. I apologize. I did not get back to you right away because I totally just didn't look at the internet for a week. It was good. Well, I mean, not all of the internet, but most of the internet I just didn't look at for a week. So then there was one more. Oh, Doc Stitcher. Docs, like Doxen. She got some of the timeline and card line games for Christmas and she really enjoyed it. And that reminded me that there were lots of actually Instagram posts of people who got games for Christmas and were enjoying them with their families. Did you get a new game? Was it fun? Did you enjoy it? I don't know. Did you like it? I hope you did. And then there's lots of fun pictures of the national parks. Okay. And then, I like this one. Blueberry chick had a daughter who had the same issue. She didn't want to go to the dentist, but she had to have a tooth that had needed to come out. And so she totally got her brother to pull her tooth out for her. I love it. She got that tooth out. And my kid is just not motivated. Whatever. And I think, oh, and then Indigo Montana, by the way, she's so beautiful. Totally, it was 30 minutes from Glacier National Park. Ah! So she was also chiming in about the Glacier National Park love. I both love Glacier National Park and Crater Lake. They're both like my top. Ooh, I would go to any national park, but they're in my dreams. They're my dream list. Just remind me of an excessively annoying dream I had last night, but I won't share with you because it was excessively annoying. Okay, but let's talk about knitting and spinning now for real. Okay. So the first thing, I did finish, finally. I finished my Knit Spin Farm bats that I bought at, I think I bought these at Knitting Pipeline last year. I think I totally did. Ooh, that's good. I can buy another bat this year. Or two. And so I have not plied it yet. I think I'm going to chain ply it. And I'm very excited about it. So that's like 7 ounces. Yay! This is a mini spinner bobbin. And this is an AcreWorks version, which I enjoy quite a lot. Hansen mini spinner. I don't know why I couldn't say the words. Anyhow. And then clearly as a person who has not spun very much recently, I clearly need to join a club, right? It was before the first of the year. It's already paid for. So I joined the Three Waters Farm Club. And this is the first installment. It's super fine merino, which I did not even hate spinning. I usually hate spinning merino, but I enjoyed this. And it was in the Camellia Forest colorway. Now you can't see all of them. There's also this wonderful green in there. So originally I was just gonna do it as a two ply, like just straight up, divide it in half and two ply it, which I did divide in half and straight. But then it occurred to me that I have this crazy awesome green, which is called It's Not Easy Being Green. It's Domestic Debulet, which I'm assuming is some sort of like Rambouillet Dorset cross. I don't know, making that up. I forgot to look it up. From Gnomespun that I got in Rhinebeck. And I think it'll be really fun to ply together. So I'm still trying to decide if I should ply them together or if I should make them two separate things and make like a foolproof or something that's stripey. I don't know, we'll see. Isn't that green so awesome? And this totally has this green in it. It'll be kind of awesome. Anyway, so there's that. So yay, that! And you have all 4 ounces of that Three Waters Farm spun. Okay, let's talk about spinning. Knitting. That's the thing. Oh, finished objects. I'm wearing one. This is my beeswax hat. This is not a new finished object. This is an old one. It's in Leading Men Fiber Arts Copper Cloud. It's super awesome. I need to reblock it because the brim has gotten really stretched out. And it wants to fall off my head very easily. Today I was doing errands and I had to do it this way because it kept sliding off my head, but it still works. Okay. I finished. I also finished two things that I won't show you this time. I finished Tova's cowl that I showed you last time, which was the Perula cowl. So I'll show you that next time. And then my interlude shawl, I also finished that, which is with the Susan B. Anderson Bartlett wool. But I'll show you that next time. Please let that be the screenshot YouTube uses. So pretty. So I finished my building blocks. What? I totally did, people. I only did the medium size because I've got to be honest with you. By the time I got to the medium, I was completely over it. completely. I think that's partly because I used a US 1 to try to get close enough to gauge. I should have just gone with a bigger needle size, but I was afraid of running out of yarn. I don't know why I thought that, because I had 4 skeins of yarn. But in my head, it was the reality that lived in my head. So my yarn is Miss Babs, and I'll show you what I had left of each colorway. I won't remember which ones they are because I'm a human. Don't judge me. Okay. So this was my color A. I had quite a bit. Normally, for the large size, you would go another section with A and B. So this was A, this was B, this was C, and this was D. So I have quite, I mean, this is probably 100 grams right here. So I have enough to do something else, but not for a long time, because I'm done looking at that. It's totally enjoyable yarn, and it was great pattern. It was just, by the time I got to the end, I was on those US ones, and it's over 500 stitches, which is not crazy. I mean, certainly I've done more than that in a row, but the fact that you're switching between knitting and purling, because it's stockinette and reverse stockinette, I was just over it. That said, I'm actually very pleased with the size of it because it is super long and super narrow, which is kind of what I'm realizing is my favorite shape. Because I don't actually like to wear shawls. I like to wear scarves. Do you know what I mean? Like, I like to wear fat scarves. It's kind of where I'm at. So anyway, I totally dig it. Fix my hat back. Because clearly, you're here for the beauty. I know that my viewers are all about aesthetics. That's why they tune in. But so anyway, I totally dig it. And when you're wearing it all, it's like, you just like have like 75 shawls on. Because of all the crazy, right? Which I think is one of the beautiful things about people who did them with like crazy varying colors. Is that it really does look like you have like 1,000 shawls on. Which is so fun. Oh, all the wrapping, all the goodness. It's great. So again, that's the Building Blocks Cal. I didn't say that's by Stephen West. And my yarn was Miss Babs Yummy 2-Ply. I'll put the colorway in the show notes. Is that all I finished? Yeah, that and those two other things I didn't even show you. This episode's too long anyway, right? Okay, so then one more thing. Right, no, two more things. Okay, I'll show you the small thing first. I did work on some sockety socks. So I have one sock minus its Afterthoughts heel. Isn't that cute? This was like my Christmassy cast on. This is Arnie and Carlos, which is by Regia. 4-ply. Dude, I have 6-ply. I might have 2 skeins. DK Arnie and Carlos socks coming my way. This is color 03760. But anyway, so yay. I'm totally digging it. So there's that. Are too many things and no tables. Except my boob table. Boob table, don't fail me now! Well, that should be the name of the show. I'm sorry, 2016 was kind of stagnant, folks. Happens, right? Need to spice it up for 2017. I lost my pen. Don't feel me now, boob shelf. Come on, remember me. Send me some remembering vibes, people. Okay. Where did I put that pen, though? I mean, really. Okay, there it is. Oh my gosh. Right. Do you have these pins? My mom is a quilter, so she told me about these pins. The brand is Frixion. F-R-I-X-I-O-N. And they totally erase with heat. So you can either use an iron to erase them, or you can, there's an eraser on them. And they literally erase from the heat of the friction. They're very cool. They make markers. They make, which are very good for your little planners because they're only like semi-transparent. And they make ink pens. They're very fun. I highly recommend them. Anywho. Okay, the other thing I'm knitting. Okay. So this one has a tiny story. Not a big story, don't worry. I was going to make, so excited, Brooklyn Tweed, when they, I think it was their fall collection. Do you remember me talking about this pattern? It's called Auster. A-U-S-T-E-R. And it's by Michelle Wang, right? Now that I've said that, it doesn't sound like that's a real person. It sounds like that's a fancy person. Oh my gosh, what is wrong with me? Anyway. So I liked this pattern enough that I immediately bought yarn for it. It's Michelle Wang, is that what I said? I immediately bought yarn for it. Now, it was written for Brooklyn Tweed's Quarry, which is a bulky single ply. And for me, I think the sweater would have cost like $280 or something for my giant size. So that was not really reasonable for me. So I purchased Cascade Eco Wool. Do you know what Cascade Eco Wool is? That one that comes in a giant skein. It's like an 8-ounce skein. This is not even a full skein. And it is like an errand to a bulky. It's a similar gauge. So I was so jazzed about it. I bought the yarn and then I bought the pattern and was like, yes, I'm going to cast that on as soon as the yarn comes. I might even get it. I think it was like right after Rhinebeck or something. Or maybe it was right before Rhinebeck. And then I actually looked at the pattern and I was like, hell no. For one thing, it's knit in pieces. Hell no. Number A. I know A's not a number. Stop judging me. But B, I should have known better, right? And it's actually totally might be completely fine. But it has these crazy sleeves, right? It's kind of like a poncho sweater. It's a... you can't put those words together. It's a swancho. Okay? But when you scale it up for my size, this sleeve has a 28-inch circumference. So basically, Megan, just run it, could totally wear my sleeve as her sweater. That's from the Stuck in the Zubbies. And I was just like, this may be a pattern that does not scale up well. So I'm going to hold back and see if maybe some super awesome other fatty knits this. And if she does, high five, super awesome other fatty. High five. But I'm not going to be the first victim, super awesome fatty. I'm not going to be that brave. I'm just not. Gotta admit it. Also, it's knit flat. Ugh. And yes, clearly you can make anything work in the round that's knit flat. But, I don't know. It's a raglan sleeve, which is already complicated. And then you start monkeying around with making that raglan sleeve smaller, but yet not making it so small that it looks like a regular sweater that you just don't know how to make an armpit for. It felt too dangerous. So luckily, Brooklyn Tweed introduced another pattern, which I think is in the winter collection, which I was like, oh, we'll just do that one instead. And that was... Oh, I did it. Just put that down. Sorry. Did I not write it down? Oh, no, I did. Okay, that's right. It's the Kirwin, K-I-R-W-I-N, by Julie Hoover. And it is another poncho-y-ish one. But it is slightly less crazy pants. So here is the Kirwin. It is also knit with Brooklyn Tweed, but it's knit with their worsted weight. So it's knit with a shelter. I know, right? I'm the worst human. If I were better, I would insert these pictures. But again, you're here for the aesthetics, right? You kind of got it there. So it's written at a worsted gauge, and now, of course, this yarn is not worsted. But that's okay, because I can just go down, in my case, a size and a half. There's a big gap between two of the sizes. So I'm just going down a size and a half. And here is mine so far. Am I in the middle of the row? No, I'm not. And this is also knit flat, but I'll forgive it. I don't know why. It didn't offend me that this was knit flat. Knit flat. Probably because there wasn't also a sleeve. Oh, so here's mine so far. Yes, this is just one side. Dial it back. Probably you also don't need to go to Weight Watchers. Just saying. You're welcome. So this is one size. One side. And of course, it's a poncho. It's supposed to be oversized, but I'm not going to admit to you. It's like that panty phenomenon where you get a package of panties and you open up and you're like, oh my gosh, I ordered the wrong size because these are huge. I'm just going to try them on for a lark because it'll be like, ha ha, character in them anyway. They're open underpants. And you put them on and they fit. And you're like, son of a bitch. So it's like that. Okay. So that's that so far. And then I forgot. The other thing I want to show you is that I love to drink Kool-Aid. So I totally did it. And I cast on the Find Your Fade. I think there are going to be people doing cowls for this. If I'm not mistaken, I'm eating my own hair. Don't tell me how many Weight Watchers points that is. Just back off. Oh, I think Yarn Hoarder, if I'm not mistaken, is doing a cow. And I'm sure other people are too. I just don't know about it. Or maybe she was going to. I don't know if she actually is, but whatever. So here's my tiny one started so far. I told my husband that this was his bathing suit for the summer because that's totally what it looks like. Banana hammock. But again, it's, you know, it's going to be great. So this was some hedgehog fibers, I think Monet or something, and then a super precioso leftover of some cakewalk yarns, and then a leftover of some jellyfish, Miss Babs, it's jellyfish something, but jellyfish. So that's my fade so far, right? You get the blue, and then the blue's got the orange in it. And then this orange is still, you got this pink's got this orange in it. And then you're all like, spun right round in her Sugar Pop Fizz colorway, which is amazing. So then there's that one. This is the only full skein I'm using. Yeah, that's true. And then from that into some Madeline Tosh, is this one Maple Leaf? I'm pretty sure. You can see it's totally got that green in there. And then for that, into some Malabrigo single ply, because it totally has a tiny bit of that in there. And then if I have room, some Gale's Art. Do you feel the fade? Do you feel it? So you can totally, a lot of people are using full skeins for this. But you can use scraps, yo. The first couple of colors only need like 25 grams. I don't have the list here. Yes, I do. It's like 20 grams, then 25 grams, then like, I mean, nothing needs more than 80 grams, I think. So if you've got a stash of scraps, you can totally make it happen. Not that you need to, I'm just saying you can. Like I really wanted to do one and I was like, I cannot justify me personally purchasing 7 skeins of yarn because I have so much yarn stash. But I didn't think I would have anything. I wanted there to be like a pop of color in there and I wasn't sure I could make that happen. So I thought, well, I'll just get down the giant bin of scraps and see what can happen. I think I'm really pleased with, I am really pleased with what I've come up with and I'm excited about it. So yeah, 20 grams, 40 grams, 60 grams, 65 grams, 70 grams, 80 grams, 50 grams. And you don't even have to have that. For example, my cakewalk, I don't have quite the full amount, but the only thing she asks is that you not make the color change inside of a lace portion. So there's quite a bit of, there's quite a few garter rows between each lace portion. And normally you're supposed to do your like fade down here right after the lace. But in my case, I had less of this cakewalk, so I moved it further up, and then I'll probably move the jellyfish further down. So again, if you don't have quite the amount, I mean, if you're short like 5 grams, 10 grams, I don't know, 10 grams, maybe not, I don't know. But, you know, you can tell me it can happen. And it's fun. And I'm not knitting on US ones, because that's crazy. I don't think it was necessarily just the ones. It was tedious to go back and forth between stockinette and on the building blocks. I'm sorry. You're not inside my brain, are you? You're welcome. You don't want to be in here. It's very crowded. But on the building blocks, again, I really like this finished object, and I really enjoyed knitting it up until the last two sections. But you have to do an increase decrease like every 36 stitches or something like that. So you have to have markers every 14 to 18 stitches. So that's a lot of time slowingness to A, slip those, and to B, remember like, okay, is this a slip slip knit or knit two together or make one, or do you know what I mean? So that's a lot. And then you're switching between textures. And so it just, I won't knit another one for quite some time. But I did really like it. I think maybe a sport one though. That would be fun. Sport weight building blocks. That would be sweet. Okay. And then I think the last thing, let's consult the magic book. Did that? Okay. And then the last thing is, Okay, and then the last thing is, hopefully I remember to edit that part out, because otherwise it'll be really weird. But whatever, you will. It's crazy. I'm going to give prizes out to folks who donated to the podcast in November and December. If you don't know what the hey diddle fiddle I'm talking about, hey, guess what? You can donate to the podcast. If you scroll all the way down to the bottom of your screen, if you're on a mobile device, you'll see a yellow donate now button. Or if you're on a laptop or some other like actual computer thing that weighs more than 3 ounces, it's usually on the full right-hand side of the blog, which is thefatsquirrel.com, which is where you can also find show notes and important information. Okay. There's also a yellow donate now button. And really, it would be great, super awesome, is if you donated a quarter for every episode or every episode you like. If you don't like an episode, don't donate a quarter for that. Don't reward me. But that ends up being like $1 every other month, or even better, $1.50 every 3 months. Because what I'm going to do next time is switch to every quarter to do prizes. Because it was a little stressful to try to come up with a new prize every 2 months. I know it's just a little bit different, but it's helpful to me. So actually, don't have your prizes for next time, for next reward cycle. But I will get that to you next time, because I'm deliberating still. That was part of the reason I delayed in podcasting. I just could not make a decision, so do the podcast and then make the decision. That's okay. So if you want to donate $1.50 every quarter, every month that's divisible by 3, that would be super awesome. Literally super awesome. So thank you guys so much. I really do appreciate it. Like, with deep and true sincerity and mind calmingness, thank you if you donate to the podcast. So this month, this time, this every other month, the two prize winners are you ready? Lisa W. I don't know where you live because PayPal didn't tell me. But Lisa W., if you donated on December 4th to the podcast, and if your email address contains the name of a bug that likes to fly and lives around wet, marshy areas, then you're a winner. Trust me, if those 3 things are you, you're you. There's nobody else. You win a prize! The New Hampshire Knits totally sold in her podcast, in her shop, the Woolly Thistle. Next winner is Maureen J. If you're Maureen J and you live in Ann Arbor, Michigan, and you have a Comcast email address, you totally win a prize. You donated on November 10th. Thank you so much. You ladies are awesome. All you folks are awesome. Yeah, you. All right, kids. Is that enough of me talking? Heck yes, it is. I hope you have a great week, and I'll talk next time. Bye.